Hello everybody, this is Jörg once again from YouTube channel Juggler 66, or Hour of the Truth as the channel also is named. I'm back today for another reading of Rulers of Evil, and I have arrived at chapter 22, which is called The Immaculate Conception. Without any further ado, I will start reading The Immaculate Conception. As if it weren't enough that Christopher Columbus had dedicated the New World Order to her, and that Andrew White had dedicated Maryland to her, and that Bishop Carroll had dedicated his See of Baltimore to her, the 1846 Convention of American Roman Catholic Bishops declared the Virgin Mary to be, quote-unquote, patroness of the United States. Quote. That is very Protestant, isn't it? The first 2 years under her patronage enriched the national government considerably. The Oregon Territory and the Southwest joined the Union, as did California with its bursting veins of gold. The blessings had their downside, however. They precipitated a corresponding increase in intersectional tensions that erupted in a devastating interstate bloodbath, some historians call the Civil War. In that war, the patroness of the United States dealt as cruelly with the enemies of her protectorate as the vengeful goddess Ishtar did with the enemies of ancient Babylon. In February 1849, Pio Nono, the popular name for Pope Pius IX, if you've probably remembered because I always use that name, there's a boulevard even named after him in Macon, in Georgia, in Macon, sorry, it's not French, I pronounce that French, Macon, it's Macon, Georgia. Pope Pio Nino issued an encyclical that colored America's patroness with the fearsome aspects of Ishtar. The encyclical, entitled Ubi Primum, by whom at first, celebrated Mary's divinity, saying, quote, "The resplendent glory of her merits, far exceeding all the choirs of angels, elevates her to the very steps of the throne of God. Her foot has crushed the head of Satan." Sorry, I have to interrupt here. Her foot has crushed the head of Satan? Where is that standing in? The Bible that I read is the seed of the woman that crushes the head of Satan. That's Jesus, not Mary. Okay, sorry, I'm gonna start this again. I had to laugh at it. So, the quote goes, "The resplendent glory of her merits, far exceeding all the choirs of angel, elevates her to the very steps of the throne of God. Her foot has crushed the head of Satan. Set up between Christ and his church, Mary, ever lovable and full of grace, always has delivered the Christian people from their greatest calamities and from the snares and assaults of all their enemies, ever rescuing them from ruin." Unquote. Isn't that so blasphemous? You know, if it wasn't that bad, it would quite be funny, actually. Okay, the author continues, "Holy as she may sound, a Satan-bashing, life-saving Virgin Mary is a fabrication of sacred pagan tradition. The Bible does prophesy that Satan's serpentine head will be violated, but not by Mary. At Genesis 3 verse 15 we read God's vow that Satan's seed will be bruised by the seed of Eve. It may be argued that Eve's seed was Mary, but according to the inspired understanding of the apostles, it was Jesus. At Romans 16 verse 20, Paul promises a Roman congregation that the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet. Nor was Mary given power to deliver people from their enemies. Only the, quote, one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, unquote, as we read in 1 Timothy 2 chapter verse 5, a, quote, a name which is above every other name, unquote, as we can read in Philippians chapter 2 verse 9, is a divinely authorized deliverer. No, the Mary of Ubi Primum will not be found anywhere in the Bible. But then Pio IX, the first pope ever to be declared infallible, carried out a rather famous theological ignorance. His private secretary, Monsignor Talbot, defended Pio's ineptitude in a letter cited by Jesuit author Peter de Rosa in his book Vicars of Christ. Quote, "As the Pope is no great theologian, I feel convinced that when he writes his encyclicals, he is inspired by God. Ignorance is no bar to infallibility, since God can point out the tight road even by the mouth of a talking ass." Unquote. The truth of the matter, according to G.C.H. Eveling, is that throughout Pius IX's long reign, that lasted between 1846 and 1878, that was the most long reign we ever had by a pope in the history of the popes, by the way, most of his theology was written by Jesuits. On December 8th, 1854, Superior General Bex, you know, the one I mentioned already in chapter 21 before here, brought 300 years of Marian devotion to a glorious climax with Infallibilis Deus, meaning God indescribable. The encyclical defining the Immaculate Conception, the extra scriptural doctrine that Mary, like Jesus, was conceived and remained free of sin. Quote, "The doctrine which holds that the Most Blessed Virgin Mary, in the first instant of her conception, by a singular grace and privilege granted by Almighty God, in view of the merits of Jesus Christ, the Savior of the human race, was preserved free from all stain of original sin, is a doctrine revealed by God, and therefore to be believed firmly and constantly by all the faithful." Unquote. Now, just reading the last part of the sentence again, and I want you to listen closely, because that's the way it has to be understood. "In view of the merits of Jesus Christ, the Savior of the human race, was preserved free from all stain of original sin, is a doctrine revealed by God, and therefore to be believed firmly and constantly by all the Catholics." The text says faithful, and faithful means Catholics, because only when you're a Catholic you can believe this, because then you do not follow the true Christian doctrine. Infallibilis Deus mobilized the United States Congress to pass extraordinary legislation. Congress became suddenly obsessed with expanding the Capitol's dome. According to the official publication, The Dome of the United States Capitol, an Architectural History from 1992, quote, "Never before or since has an addition to the Capitol been so eagerly embraced by Congress." Unquote. Within days of Pio IX's definition of the doctrine of Immaculate Conception, legislation was rushed through Congress that effectively incorporated the new Vatican doctrine into the Capitol Dome's crowning architectural platform, its cupola. A week following Infallibilis Deus, Philadelphia architect Thomas Eustick Walter, a Freemason, completed his drawings for the proposed dome. It would be surmounted by a bronze Marian image, which would come to be recognized as, quote, "the only authorized symbol of American heritage." Unquote. Her classical name was Persephone, Greco-Roman goddess of the psyche, or soul, and leading deity in the Eleusinian mysteries of ancient Greece. Persephone was abducted by Saturn's son, Hades. I repeat the sentence again. Sorry, I was not quite good with my pronunciation. Persephone was abducted by Saturn's son, Hades, and made queen consort of his dominion, the underworld. Persephone was distinguished for her immaculate conception, described by Proclus, head of the Platonic Academy in Athens during the 5th century of the Christian era, as, quote, her undefiled transcendency in her generations, unquote. In fact, most of the statues of Persephone in the Christianized Roman Empire had been simply re-identified and reconsecrated as the Virgin Mary by missionary adaptation. Remember chapter 2, missionary adaptation of this book, Rulers of Evil? And remember how I pointed out in earlier chapters that when you go to St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, and there you have the statue of Peter, that is actually the statue of Jupiter taken from the Pantheon and just renamed, re-baptized as the whole Roman Empire baptized itself with the garments of Christianity, as you probably know by now. The author continues that Congress appropriated $3,000 for a statue of Persephone. President Franklin Pierce's Secretary of War, Jefferson Davis, awarded the commission to famous young American sculptor named Thomas Crawford. Crawford lived and worked in Rome. His reputation had been established with a statue of Orpheus, which, when exhibited in Boston in 1843, was the first sculptured male nude to be seen in the United States. Since another of Persephone's ancient names was Libera, meaning liberty, Crawford named his Persephone Freedom. His work has worn this title ever since. After 2 years of labor in the shadow of the Jesu, Crawford completed a plaster model of Freedom. Her right hand rested on a sword pointing downward. Her left hand, against which leaned the shield of the United States, held a laurel wreath. She was crowned with an eagle, head and feathers mounted on a tiara of pentagrams, some inverted, some not. When ultimately cast in bronze, Freedom would reach the height of 19 feet, 6 inches, a sum perhaps deliberately calculated to pay homage to the work's final destination, the Beast of Revelation at Lot 666, you remember from chapter 20 when I read that, for 19 feet, 6 inches work out to 6, 6 and 6 feet, 6 plus 6 plus 6 inches. Freedom would stand upon a 12-foot iron pedestal, also designed by Thomas Crawford. The upper part of the pedestal was a globe ringed with the motto of the Bacchic Gospel, E Pluribus Unum. Well, we discussed that already in earlier parts of the book. While the lower part was flanked with 12 wreaths, the 12 Caesars maybe, and as many fasci, those bundle of rods wrapped around axe blades symbolizing Roman totalitarianism. And you put that up on the roof of the Capitol? What does that have to do with Protestantism in the government, I ask you? So once again, we have to understand that the founding of the government of the United States of America from the beginning was Roman Catholicism. It was Romanism through and through, and by that it was Babylonianism. I've shown you so many things right now from the beginning of the book up to now that lead to there, that you just have to understand what a evil government you have over there in the United States of America. It's not that I have any better over here in Europe. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that. But, I mean, we don't call ourselves a Protestant anymore. And surely not our governments aren't Protestant. I think anybody can see that. And it is time that the Americans acknowledge that their Protestantism has gone and it needs to be revived. And it needs to be revived strongly, and it needs to be revived right now. And this is why I do these readings, to point out to you in what kind of a nightmare you actually live in, that you can turn around to the Bible, seek and find Jesus Christ, and revive Protestantism in your country. Because that's the only thing that saves you, the Bible, and nothing else. You have to go back to your roots. You have to go back to Protestantism that founded your country in the first place. It is imperative that you understand that Romanism not only rules the United States of America, but through the United States of America, it rules the whole world. And there's a quote that I can read to you. Yeah, sorry, I was looking for a few minutes for this link. I cannot find it. I know that I have it somewhere. I read it before also. I think it was on the broadcast of Hour of the Truth. And it went like, when the Roman Catholic Church rules the United States of America, it rules the world. And you know, from that moment in 1984 on, when President Reagan was inaugurated facing the obelisk that was a sign for the Jesuits, that the Roman Catholic Church has taken over the United States of America. And from that time on, it rules the world. And we have to understand that. And the only thing we can do about that is find back our Protestantism that has made us here in Europe and that has made you over there in the United States of America that great a nation that you once were, and now you're in decline. Why? Because everywhere where the Roman Catholic Church rules supreme, the people get poor and oppressed. And now look around you over there in the United States of America. What happened to you? So visibly, at least since 9/11, that everybody can see it. Are you start losing your rights? Are you starting to lose your freedom? I think so. And why is that? Because your country turns more and more Catholic every day. And the only enemy of Catholicism in this world is the Bible. That's why Catholicism doesn't teach the Bible. That's why Catholicism suppresses and forbids the Bible. Protestantism is the Bible put into action. And you have to go back to that. These fasces, these bundles of rods wrapped around X-blades symbolizing Roman totalitarianism. When you have that on the top of your Capitol building, you cannot by any means call your country Protestant anymore. That means you have to go back and find your Protestant roots again. Okay, the author continues on the bottom of page 238. Crawford wanted his sculpture to be cast at the Royal Bavarian Foundry in Munich, where Randolph Rogers' great 10-ton bronze doors leading to the Capitol Rotunda were cast. While architect Thomas U. Walter preferred Clark Mills Foundry near Washington. Their transatlantic argument ended abruptly when Crawford died in London on September 10, 1857, of a tumor behind his left eye. In that same year, 1857, the United States Supreme Court handed down Dred Scott v. Sanford, a decision which, was most historians agree, ignited the Great American Civil War. The opinion was written by the Roger Brooke Taney, who succeeded John Marshall as Chief Justice. A devout Roman Catholic, quote, under the influence of the Jesuits of his most of his long life, unquote, according to Dr. Walsh's American Jesuits, Taney held that Negro slaves and their descendants could never be state citizens, and thus could never have standing in court to sue or be sued. Nor could they ever hope to be United States citizens, since the Constitution did not create such a thing as United States citizenship. Taney's opinion was widely suspected of being part of a plot to prepare the way for a second Supreme Court decision that would prohibit any state from abolishing slavery. American slavery would become a permanent institution. Well, that's what happened after this Civil War. This is exactly what happened, although not quite as everyone supposed it would. First, slavery was abolished by the 13th Amendment in 1865. Then, the 14th Amendment in 1868 created a new national citizenship. Unlike state citizenship, which was denied to Negroes, national citizenship was available to anyone, as long as they subjected themselves to the jurisdiction of the United States, that is, to the federal government, whose seat is the District of Columbia, Rome. What is so remarkably Jesuitic about that scheme, about the scheme that proceeded out of Roger Taney's opinion, is that slavery was sustained by the very amendment that supposedly abolished it. Amendment 13 provides for the abolition of involuntary servitude, except as punishment for crime whereof the party shall have been duly convinced. In our time, the federally regulated communications media, with their continually exciting celebration of violence and drug use, have subtly but vigorously induced youthful audiences to play on a minefield of complementary criminal statutes. The fruit of this collaboration is a burgeoning national prison population of men and women enslaved constitutionally. American slavery has become a permanent institution. And how right is that when you consider 2015, which is 20 years almost later after the publishing of this book? The United States of America is the country with the most inmates in prison worldwide, considering their population. And the prisons are now, for a big part, privatized. Private prisons. What does that have to do with punishment by the state anyway? Whereof the party shall have been duly convicted. Yeah, duly convicted by whom to do what? I mean, this is just a scam, you know. American slavery has become a permanent institution. You know what they did? To put it in easy words, they freed the blacks and enslaved the white at the same time. They so-called freed the blacks. No, they enslaved all the white. They freed nobody. They enslaved all of them. They just didn't tell you. Isn't that a nice scheme? Yeah? You go to war to abolish slavery, and what you do is, at the end of the war, you find yourself in slavery. The thing that you wanted to abolish, you are now ended up in yourself. With the 14th Amendment, the United States of America made sure all its citizens were their slaves, whether black, yellow, green, red, or white. Doesn't matter what color you have, you are a United States citizen under the District of Columbia, you are a slave to that government. And when you want to be free, you can turn to Jesus. That's the only way that you can be free in America and also here in Europe. American slavery has become a permanent institution. Reaction to Taney's decision animated Abraham Lincoln to immerse himself in abolitionist rhetoric and challenge Stephen A. Douglas for the Senate in 1858. Meanwhile, in Rome, the author continues, Freedom's plaster matrix was packed into 5 huge crates and crammed with bales of rags and cases of lemons into the hold of a tired old ship bound for New York, the Emily Taylor. Early on, the Emily sprang a leak and had to put up to, into Gibraltar for repairs. Once the voyage was resumed, stormy weather caused new leaks. Despite attempts to lighten her load by jettisoning the rags and the citron, things got so bad she put into Bermuda on July 27, 1858. The crates were placed in storage and the Emily was condemned and sold. In November, In November, Lincoln lost his bid for Douglas' seat in the Senate, and in December, another ship, the G.W. Norton, arrived in New York Harbor from Bermuda with some of the statuary crates. By March 30, 1859, all 5 crates had been delivered to the foundry of Clark Mills of Bladensburg Road on the outskirts of the District of Columbia, where the process of casting the Immaculate Virgin into bronze and iron was begun. Lincoln opposed Stephen Douglas again in 1860, this time for the presidency, and this time victoriously. The northern states rejoiced. The southern states, fearing Lincoln would abolish slavery, prepared to secede. Quote, "The tea has been thrown overboard," unquote, to come back to the tea and taxes scam of the Constitutional War. Of the, yeah, you know what I mean. "The tea has been thrown overboard," shouted the Mercury of Charleston, South Carolina, capital of American Scottish Rite Freemasonry. Quote, "The revolution of 1860 has been initiated," unquote. By Lincoln's inauguration in March 1861, 6 states had seceded from the Union. In April, General Pierre Beauregard, a Roman Catholic who resigned his superintendency of West Point to join the Confederacy, fired on the United States military enclave at Fort Sumter, and brotherly blood began flowing. Jefferson Davis, who 5 years earlier had commissioned Crawford to scalp the Immaculate Virgin, served as president of the rebellious Confederate States of America. In historian Eli N. Evans' book on Jude P. Benjamin, I happened upon a strange and interesting link between Davis and the Vatican. While a young Protestant student at the Roman Catholic Monastery of St. Thomas College in Bardstown, Davis had pled to be received into the Catholic faith, but was, quote, "not permitted to convert," unquote. He remained a hazy Protestant until his confirmation into the Episcopal Church at the age of 50. Despite outward appearances of rejection, the Confederate president maintained a vibrant communion with Rome. No one was more aware of this than Abraham Lincoln. At an interview in the White House during August 1861, Lincoln confided the following to a former law client of his, a Roman Catholic priest named Charles Chiniquy, who published the president's words in his own autobiography, 50 Years in the Church of Rome. A wonderful, wonderful book I advise everybody to read. You can get it for free on the internet as PDF and download it. 50 Years in the Church of Rome. That will give you such a wonderful insight also into the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. It's a great, great book. Okay, the quote reads, "I feel more and more every day," stated the President Abraham Lincoln, "that it is not against the Americans of the South alone I am fighting. It is more against the Pope of Rome, his Jesuits and their slaves. Very few Southern leaders are not under the influence of the Jesuits, through their wives, family relations, and their friends. Several members of the family of Jeff Davis belong to the Church of Rome. Even the Protestant ministers are under the influence of the Jesuits without suspecting it. To keep her ascendancy in the north, as she does in the south, Rome is doing here what she has done in Mexico and in all the South American republics. She is paralyzing by civil war the arms of the soldiers of liberty. She divides our nation in order to weaken, subdue, and rule it. Neither Jeff Davis nor anyone of the Confederacy would have dared to attack the North had they not relied on the promise of the Jesuits that, under the mask of democracy, the money and the aims of the Roman Catholics, even the arms of France, were at their disposal if they would attack us. I pity the priests, the bishops, and monks of Rome in the United States when the people realize that they are in great part responsible for the tears and blood shed in this war. I conceal what I know. I conceal what I know, for if the people knew the whole truth, this war would turn into a religious war, and at once take a tenfold more savage and bloody character. Unquote. The great civil war rampaged for another year. In autumn of 1862, the Confederacy's invasion of the Union was defeated at the Battle of Antietam in Sharpsburg, Maryland. As if in celebration, the Immaculate Virgin was moved from the foundry and brought to the grounds of the Capitol construction site. The lower floors of the building were teeming with the traffic of a Union barracks and makeshift hospital. Above all, above all this loomed Thomas Hugh Walter's majestic cast-iron dome, patterned after that of St. Isaac's Cathedral in St. Petersburg, Russia. In March 1863, freedom was mounted on a temporary pedestal. Quote, "In order that the public may have an opportunity to examine it before it is raised to its destined position," unquote, as stated in Walter's annual report dated November 1, 1862. One would expect photographers to be climbing all over themselves to make portraits of, quote, "the only authorized symbol of American heritage," unquote, while she was available for ground-level examination. America's pioneer photographer, Matthew Brady, had shot a comprehensive record of the Capitol under construction, including portraits of both Capitol architect Thomas Hugh Walter and Commissioner of Public Buildings Benjamin B. French. But neither Brady nor anyone else photographed freedom while she was available for close-ups. Now, the author gives a little note here, a little footnote. He says that I was personally informed by the architect of the Capitol in 1992 that, quote, "no ground-level photographs of freedom are known to exist," unquote. So neither Brady nor anyone else photographed freedom while she was available for close-ups. Why? Was there a fear that perhaps some Protestant theologian might raise a hue and cry about the pagan icon about to dominate the Capitol building? Well, maybe some Protestants would have woken up if it had been possible to take close-up photos as long as she was on the ground, right? Well, what you gonna do today? You got in America, you got your drones, right? Well, get a drone, take a photograph, take a close-up, and you will see "E pluribus unum" written on there, on the fasces and the pentagrams, that freedom, so-called, is standing on your legislative building in Washington. Apparently not too many Protestants ever examined freedom at ground level. The District of Columbia was still virtually a Roman Catholic enclave. Moreover, the nation in 1863 had been drastically reduced in size. The secession of the southern states had left only 22 northern states, and these 22 were heavily populated by Catholic immigrants from Europe and Ireland. Quote, "so incredibly large," we recall from Sidney E. Elstrom's Religious History of the American People, "was the flow of immigrants that by 1850 Roman Catholics, once a tiny and ignored minority, had become the country's largest religious communion. Unquote. By 1850, that is 74 years after 1776. That is 160 years back from now. That is altogether 220 years. So after one third of the time the United States of America as a nation came into existence, after one third of the time, Roman Catholics became the country's largest religious communion. Remember, they were less than 1% of the population in 1776. Within 74 years, within three generations, from less than 1% of the population in the United States of America, Roman Catholics grew to the largest religious denomination. That's how they take over. And I think we're going to go to that a little bit later in this chapter also, about what's happening today with the refugee situation. But I continue reading now on the bottom of page 242. Thus, Crawford's towering goddess was being examined mostly by Roman Catholic eyes, eyes that could not help but see in her the dreadnought Mary described in Pius IX in Ubi Primum. Quote, ever lovable and full of grace, set up between Christ and his church, always delivering the Christian people from their greatest calamities and the souls of all their enemies, ever rescuing them from ruin. Unquote. The war rapidly advanced to conclusion while freedom held forth on the east grounds of the capital. The Union forces under Burnside lost to Lee at Fredericksburg, but Rosecrans defeated the Confederates at Murfreesboro, and Grant took Vicksburg. In summer, Lee's second attempt to invade the North failed at Chancellorsville at Gettysburg. By fall, Grant won the battles of Chattanooga and Missionary Ridge with Sherman and Thomas. By the end of November 1863, the Union had taken Knoxville, and the Confederacy found its resources exhausted and its cause hopelessly lost. On November 24th, a steam-operated hoisting apparatus lifted the Immaculate Virgin Mother of God's first section to the top of the Capitol Dome and secured it. The second section followed the next day. 3 days later, in a driving thunderstorm, the third section was secured. The fourth section was installed on November 31st. At 2:15, December 2nd, 1863, before an enormous crowd, the Immaculate Virgin's fifth and final section was put into place. The ritual procedure for her installation is preserved in Special Order No. 248 of the War Department. Her head and shoulders rose from the ground. The 300-foot trip took 20 minutes. At the moment the fifth section was affixed, a flag unfurled above it. The unfurling was accompanied by a national salute of 47 gunshots fired into the Washington atmosphere. 35 shots issued from a field battery on Capitol Hill. 12 were discharged from the forts surrounding the city. Reporting the event in the December 10th issue of the New York Tribune, an anonymous journalist echoed the qualities that Pius IX, Pio IX, had given Mary. Quote, during more than 2 years of our struggle, while the national cause seemed weak, she has patiently waited and watched below. Now that victory crowns our advances, and the conspirators are being hedged in and vanquished everywhere, and the bonds are being freed, she comes forward, the cynosure of thousands of eyes, her face turned rebukingly toward Virginia, and her hand outstretched as if in guarantee of national unity and personal freedom. Unquote. If Tribune readers felt more nationally united and personally free, because freedom was glaring at rebellious Virginia and outstretching her hand to her beloved America, they were deceived. For the goddess faced in precisely the opposite direction. Can you believe it? She faced east as she does to this day. Faced east across Maryland, the land of Mary, across the Atlantic toward her beloved Rome. In fact, neither hand outstretches in any direction. Both are at rest, one on her sword, the other holding the laurel wreath. And her 47 Jupiterian Thunderbolt gunshots? They were a tribute to the Jesuit bishop who had placed the District of Columbia under her protection. For December 2nd, 1863, told the 47th year from John Carroll's last full day alive, December 2nd, 1815. How about this information of the hidden faith of the founding fathers? How about this information on the hidden founding fathers? A 47-shot gun salute was brought for the inauguration of freedom that faces east. 47 gunshots. Because 47 years before, America's first Roman Catholic bishop, 26 years of Jesuit training, John Carroll, died. Do you see the Roman connection now, if not before? Do you open your eyes to the truth that is read to you here? Do you understand history now? And her 47 Jupiterian Thunderbolt gunshots, they were a tribute to Jesuit John Carroll, who had placed the District of Columbia under her protection. Okay, the author continues. Once the pressures of the installation were over, an exhausted but relieved Capitol architect Thomas U. Walter wrote his wife, Amanda, at their Philadelphia home to say that, quote, "Her ladyship looks placid and beautiful, much better than I expected, and I have had thousands of congratulations on this great event, and a general regret was expressed that you were prevented from witnessing this triumph." Unquote. Someone else has missed the triumph too. Someone who, by all the rules of protocol, should have been there, no matter what. The Commander-in-Chief of the United States Armed Forces, whose War Department had engineered the whole Capitol project from top to bottom, President Abraham Lincoln. At noon on the day the Temple of Federal Legislation was placed under the patronage of Persephone, Freedom, wife of Hades, Queen of the Dead, Immaculate Virgin of Rome, Protectress of the Jesuits, Protectress of Maryland, and Patroness of the United States of America, the record shows that Lincoln sequestered himself inside the White House, touched with a fever. A telling detail. But the sacred iconography was still not complete. The engineers began now preparing the interior of the dome, its canopy, for a massive painting Congress had approved back in the spring of 1863. This painting would depict George Washington undergoing the secular version of the canonization of Ignatius of Loyola. It contains even more data useful to our understanding of the character and provenance of American government. We examine this masterpiece in the next chapter, called The Dome of the Great Sky. Yeah. I don't have anything to add to what I just read here. Only the question, can you believe it? Do you get it? Is it making sense to you when you look around and you hear this suppressed, omitted history? Do you understand now what's going on in your country? Do you know now where your roots are really? And do you want to have these roots? Do you want to identify yourself with these roots? Or would you rather choose to identify yourself with the roots of Protestantism, with the roots of the Bible, with the roots of the Word of God, with the roots of Jesus Christ, who founded the colonies and forbid Roman Catholics to hold mass and to hold office, because they knew when you let Roman Catholics into office, they take over the politics, they take over the government, and you're doomed. Give Roman Catholics the little finger and they take the whole arm. Ah, they're even gonna take the whole body. Do you see this now? How bad you have been taught history? And you can go out there, you can go to Washington, you can look at the Statue of Freedom of yourself, of Persephone, of Hades. You can look at it for yourself. Don't believe me? Go there, examine it when you don't believe me. Check it out. Go to the rotunda and see what we were reading in the next chapter, the Dome of the Great Sky. Look at the rotunda and the deification of George Washington. I was talking about that, I think, in chapter 1 or 2 already. Well, that's far gone now in chapter 22, right? Go there, see for yourselves. The signs are everywhere. What they tell you is a lie. And in this book, and in everything that happens when you analyze it, you have proof that they are lying to you. Of course, because your nation was built for sinners, as stated in chapter 20. Remember? You cannot build a social security system for the faithful. The framers wanted to build a novus ordo that would secure liberty and justice for all. The underlying principle of this new order is the fact of human sin. To build a republic designed for sinners, then, is the indispensable task. There is no use building a social system for saints. There are too few of them, and those there are impossible to live with. Any effective social system must therefore be designed for the only moral majority there is, sinners. Michael Novak wrote that in the Jesuit magazine America, January 28, 1989, about the United States of America. That is, of those are people that rule you. You want to be ruled by them, or you want to be ruled by Jesus Christ? Then give Protestantism another chance. Get back to the Bible. Get back to biblical Christianity. And forsake Roman Catholicism, which is not only in Roman Catholic churches, but which is also in all the by Jesuits infiltrated Protestant churches over there. Not only in the United States of America, worldwide, but I'm speaking now about the United States of America. I ask my Protestant brethren in the United States of America, you are our last hope. If you don't wake up, you and that wonderful once Protestant country, then we are all doomed. You gotta make it. We count on you. We count on your spirit, that you will come back to the spirit that you once had and enjoy the love Jesus Christ taught and teaches, because he is the God of the living, living in heaven, next to the Father, right now. And I think he's in the starting blocks to come back. And when he comes back and he brings his wrath, you don't want to be on the bad side of that, I can assure you. Go back to the Bible, the King James of 1611, the only true preserved word of God in the English language we have today. Understand the book, study the book, believe the book, love the book, love your Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross to set you free from your sins. Go back to Protestantism. See how your country has been taken over by the Roman Catholic Church, the synagogue of Satan, the Church of Satan in the kingdom of the Antichrist of this materialistic world. Okay. Thank you very much for listening. Hope you enjoyed it. Hope to see you back next time. In the meantime, leave some comments. Let me know what you think. And we are going more and more coming to the climax of the book. A few chapters left. I'm looking forward to read them. I hope you're looking forward to listen to them and study with me this book, Rulers of Evil, Useful Knowledge About Governing Bodies, written by the late F. Tupper Saucy in 1996, to open our eyes to the deception that we have made to believe the whole of our lives up to now. The government of the United States of America is a corrupt, satanic, Roman Catholic government, and not something to represent the Bible, or the God of the Bible, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in any way. Until next time, I love you. God bless you all. Bye-bye.